to defense being the weak side of the ball for us now, man.
That's going to be tough for me to accept. So I'll be ranting. Like, they've got to, they've got to improve. And, you know, like Max was saying earlier, like, I'm not going for the huge win over FSU by, you know, multiple touchdowns and this and that, because think of how lousy we were. And we were within one play of beating the Jameis Winston teams.
Yep.
And Miami was bad, you know, like, yeah, struggling with Duke and other stuff. But they, those kids, they know each other. And also a little bit of Louisville is that those kids know each other, too. I know, yeah, there was a kid from St. Thomas and another, yeah, from American Heritage. So, yeah, there's familiarity, and that familiarity is tough. Like, Miami has two – I'd much rather play a team that looks and acts like Miami.
Yep.
Then play a team that's completely opposite, like
Wisconsin.
Wisconsin and Boston College.
Yeah.
That's a big team that's tough, that is going to play for four quarters. You know, so, I mean, Florida State, they're going to match up exactly like Miami. They're going to look like mirror images of each other, except we have Derek King and they have that Gumby.
Yeah.
You know, and I think that's, yeah, really the difference. The, you know, we might be a little bit better at some positions. They might be better at some positions, but the huge factor is going to be Derek, yeah, King.
Yeah. No, I completely agree with you, man. Well, so you mentioned your podcast earlier. You know, now that we're wrapping up, I would love for you to tell everyone what you got going on. Talk about your pod, anything else that you're working on. And just tell us what it's about.
Well, you know, I put out content pretty regularly. I do YouTube seriously, and I've got a couple of YouTube channels, and I executive produce, co-own the Fishing Podcast, okay, which is it's fun. And my best friend, my buddy Jeff Maggio, is like the big one of the best fishermen in Florida, in the world. And he, we got to have him on Fours Up one night because he played at St. Thomas. I've talked about him before. Uh-huh. And he was a corner at UConn. I mean, he knows, nice, a lot about football, too.
Yeah.
And I was like, since I have everything all set up, why not just, when I feel like it, throw out a, you know, a quick podcast,
yeah,
on the Canes? You know, I've already got the software and the mics and everything is all set up. And I'll probably end up doing some more. I might do a music podcast.
Yeah,
because I love how everybody's friendly on, yeah, that you guys work with Roe and, uh-huh, you work with me and are giving me a chance to promote my stuff and back vice versa, because none of us are in competition with each other.
Yeah.
We're in competition with Netflix.
Yep. Correct.
It's so easy to say, like, oh, you know, those guys, they're trying to do podcasting too. You know, the OBB boys, they shouldn't be on because we're promoting them. No, uh-huh, we're all in this together, and the rising tide lifts all the ships. And, mm-hmm, the way how this content game works, and I just saw the president of what's his name, Hastings Reed or whatever, the president of Netflix, talking about it.
Yeah.
And it's been like this for a decade now with YouTube, is if they're watching my stuff or listening to my stuff, they're not listening to theirs. And that's a huge, yeah, threat to media.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? People have been able to find their own media that they like now.
Yeah.
Like, the media is so gigantic, and half of the country hates one type of media and the other half hates the other half of the media.
Yeah.
But at the grassroots level, people like you and Marsh and people like Roe and people like me, we're creating our own stuff.
Yep.
And like, I got whatever, it wasn't a lot, but I got like 66 people on my last podcast that listened, yeah, to it. Those are 66 people that weren't watching Cobra Kai at that time of day.
Yeah. Yeah.
You know, and when it grows exponentially, like my YouTube stuff, the YouTube numbers are crazy.
Yeah.
Like, you know, 100 million views, and some days I've had, it goes anywhere from like 70,000 views a day to 200,000.
Jeez.
And you're just thinking,
amazing, man.
You're just thinking, like, we could be at the football game, and I tell my buddy Jeff, like, see all the people in the stadium? That's how many people watch the fishing videos today.
That's ridiculous, man.
It's crazy.
Yeah, and good for you guys. Like, that is so cool. You know, like it's, I don't know, the Forza doesn't do anything near that. I mean, that's like, I'm hoping one day we can do that in a month. You know, but like, just thinking about that is mind blowing to me. Like, that's so exciting for you guys. And but I'm with you.
It happened the same way, because I put up I used to put out my fishing videos on VHS. Uh-huh. And we would make them play it at a bar, or we would, you know, play it at each other's houses, because I made funny fishing videos and crazy fish and stuff. And then YouTube happened in 2006. Mm-hmm. And we were just thinking that it was a distribution point for us. Like, oh, now, like, you know, three or four of my friends can watch the videos without us having to peddle these VHS tapes. Yeah. And then one video got like 100 views. And we were like, who are these, you know, 96 other people that are watching it?
Yeah.
And then that video got 1,000 views. And you're like, wow, 1,000 views. And I mean, you know, it took like years.
Yeah.
But it's going all the way back to 2006. And then probably in 2010, 2011, I started to really get serious about it, and then the numbers really exploded.
Yeah.
And it's just...
It's amazing, man. That's so cool. And so one thing I wanted to mention is you know, you're talking about us versus Netflix. And I love the way that media is going, because it's allowing for niche, like niche media to become a thing. You know, and you talked about music a little earlier. When I was younger, I was really into like 80s rock and 70s rock. And when you look at like the album numbers that those guys were doing, like, you know, the number of units that Led Zeppelin and Van Halen and Guns N' Roses and Metallica were moving were just insane. Especially, you know, but if you think of it, like, there was no market for niche music, really, because it was radio and record stores. You know, there wasn't. And it's like, you're not going to buy a record of someone that you've never heard of. I mean, maybe some people would.
But, right. Small percentage.
Right. Right. And the internet has just changed that so much, because I think it allows things for like me and Marsh to do just Miami football. You know, it's not even just football. It's just college football. And it's not even just that. It's not even ACC football. It's the Miami Hurricanes. You know, we're taking such a small piece of pie. But modern media has allowed that.
And then the crazy thing, you know, you bring up Zeppelin or Pink Floyd or Black Sabbath. Not only are their releases huge, but then like every year, boys turn from 13 to 14 and then they discover it and they buy it again. So they go platinum again. And they've been doing that, you know, up until the mid-2000s when, you know, the whole bottom of the music industry just fell out.
Yeah.
But the kids are still finding Led Zeppelin, and Jimmy Page is still getting gigantic royalty checks every month.
Yeah. Well, I mean, I'm someone who, I mean, we talk Van Halen all the time on the Twitter timeline. Like, I was born the same year that their album For Unlawful Carnal Knowledge came out. Actually, right. After that. I was born after that. Wow. Because that was 91. I was born in 93. So, but I mean, Eddie Van Halen's the one that got me into music, and I made a replica of his guitar from 1978. Yeah. So, I mean, like, you're spot on, you know, is kids like me, like, they hear a Van Halen song for the first time and I'm like, you know, I didn't know that guitars made noises like that. It sounds like an alien, you know, but
funny thing, I love trolling the guys on the Facebook group for the Charvel guitars because they're all into Frankenstein guitars, of course.
Yeah, of course.
So I like to tease and I go, what is the deal with all these busted up like guitars? How come this doesn't happen in the Les Paul group that I'm in?
Yeah.
How come everybody in the Les Paul group, their guitar has a neck, it's strong, it's got two pickups on it. But there's like a dude here that's got a Charvel neck and is looking for an 83 body. Like, are you guys all pawn shop losers? Like, what's going on here with these guitars and all kinds of disrepair? And they're like, you can't modify a Les Paul, this and that.
You know, I think my favorite part about that story, though, which is very on brand, is that you're trolling a Charvel Facebook group.
If you knew. Oh my gosh.
Oh man. Dude, whichever FBI agent is monitoring you, you know, because they watch all of us, right? I bet everyone at the FBI is like hoping to monitor you on the internet, because I just love your trolling, man. It kills me.
Yeah, just occasionally just do insane searches in Google. You know what I mean? Like, yeah. what country sells dwarfs or something? And then the FBI guy who's monitoring my thing is like, what's this guy going to do?
Oh, we need to monitor if he makes any phones or any phone calls to Kyrgyzstan or however you say it.
Exactly.
Yeah. But anyways, crazy. Man, is there anything else you want to add before we wrap up?
No, just feeling pretty good about the team. Expectations aren't super high.
Okay.
You know what I mean? Like, I'm fully prepared to get kicked in the nuts against Clemson.
Yeah.
It'll be great if we hang with them for four quarters and pull out a crazy upset win. But nothing changes after that game. Even if Miami gets stomped, the goal of this year was not surpassing Clemson. It was to stop losing to jerk-off teams.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? And the next step for Miami is, like you were saying, that, you know, tipped balls and this and that, they're going to get some touchdowns instead of field goals against us. So Miami's going to have to learn to play with some adversity where, you know, last year they folded as soon as they saw adversity, and they're going to have to learn how to win some close games.
Yeah.
You know, everything's been perfect up until this point against, you know, a veteran UAB team and a pretty similar Louisville team in terms of speed and skill.
Yeah.
So, yeah, we're going to play, you know, North Carolina and a couple others, Virginia Tech and them. Virginia Tech knows Miami like the back of their hand, and that's a pretty good barometer for Miami. Yeah. Like, if Miami can handle Virginia Tech physically and not choke and everything, you're on your way pretty good. That's a good barometer for us to gauge success on, because, I mean, it was more so under Beamer and that defensive coordinator guy they had. But Virginia Tech, like, showed up. They're going to play four quarters. They're going to hit you in the mouth. And if you don't have, you know, everything tidied up, they'll exploit it.
Yeah, I agree with you, man. And hey, like, if you do that music podcast, I would absolutely love to come on and talk power metal with you, or you know, Van Halen or something like that. I mean, I don't know.
Definitely. I'll set it up. I'm always transitioning away from traditional media into this.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, I mean, whether you want to talk, like, you know, the type of stuff with Cookie Monster, I could do, you can do that. Or, you know, I'd love to geek out about that Euro power metal stuff. The guys with the really high voices that sing like they're, you know, they're opera singers, and the drummers are going insane. Love it.
I went, like, I guess it was probably 2 years ago. There's a small venue kind of, you know, mile or two from my house that gets some good bands. And it was like a weird night, and they're like, Europe is playing.
Cool.
And I was like, well, I only know their one song, but it's, you know, like $22. What am I going to do, sit at home? So I went. Mm-hmm. Not only were they like top 10 tightest bands I've ever seen live.
Really?
I was the only person there that didn't know every word to every song.
Okay.
Like, I kind of, you know, like, hang in the back.
Yeah.
A lot of underage and stuff. And I was just looking around, and I'm like, wow, I know that one, you know, cheesy song by Europe, The Countdown.
Yeah.
But everybody else here knows every song, and this band is frigging tight.
Like, that's cool.
They're really good live. You can tell they performed thousands of times.
Yeah. You know, I had an experience with a band like that. And speaking of power metal, they kind of fit into that genre. Have you ever heard of the band Sabaton? They're from Sweden.
Yes, I have.
Yeah, they do the military history type thing. Every song is about war.
Right.
And so I saw them as an opener for, I think it was Nightwish. I can't remember. But anyways, I saw them, and exactly how you just described Europe. Like, they were so tight. They were, like, I walked away thinking that is one of the best live bands I've ever seen. And, dude, their fans were just rabid, you know?
Yeah.
Like, flags were coming out. And this is a small venue in Salt Lake City. And, you know, people are, like, holding up these long, like, 6-foot-long Sabaton flags. I'm like, I'd never even heard of this band before today. You know, it's crazy, man. I love music, and live music especially.
Oh, me too. Yeah. This is killing me, not being able to go anywhere and see anybody.
I know. This is probably the first year in, man, I don't know how long, that I haven't seen at least 5 or 6 concerts, and I've seen 0. So
at that same venue, I forget who I went to see, but it was